time to start. So welcome all to this Aleksanteri alumni talk with Andrew Graan, talking about state and political reform in Macedonia, and Brendan Humphries as discussant. So Andrew Graan is researcher at the University of Helsinki, and he's a cultural and linguistic anthropologist with interest in political communication and contemporary forms of transnational governance, and public culture and nation branding, among other topics. And the geographical areas he covers are Macedonia, more specifically, the Balkans, and the European Union more broadly. His current research in the Republic of Macedonia develops a social, cultural, and linguistic anthropological approach to these topics. And he's published widely in several outlets, and his latest publication is titled Seeing Double: Political Polarization and the Identity Politics in North Macedonia Before and After the Prespa Agreement. And Andrew was a visiting fellow at the Aleksanteri Institute in 2012, am I right? I guess so, quite a long time ago. And Brendan Humphries is a senior researcher at the Aleksanteri Institute, and his research interests include the Balkans, Soviet studies, Cold War, sociology of conflict, and nationalism and exceptionalism, among other things. And he's currently working on a project with other colleagues at the Aleksanteri Institute titled Yugoslav Prison Nationalism, the Politics of Punishment in the Contemporary Western Balkans. And Brendan's most recent book project is titled, at least preliminarily, or it will be titled, Really Existing Nationalism, State, People and Nation in Cold War Socialist Europe. Okay, so Andrew, please, the floor is yours. And oh yes, and as you see, we are recording now, but we are just recording the talk and comments, and not the Q&A session.
Well, hello, one and all. Thank you for being here this afternoon, and special thanks to Anna for this really warm introduction and the kind invitation to present my research. Anna was a really wonderful host during my time as a visiting fellow at the Aleksanteri Institute and remains a cherished colleague. So it's a real honor and privilege to be participating in this seminar today. And I'm also really pleased to have Brendan as my discussant. When I first arrived at the Aleksanteri Institute, I was lucky enough to be sharing an office suite with Brendan, among other colleagues, and he quickly became a fast friend and an important interlocutor. And so I'm especially excited to benefit from his commentary on this work in progress. Just one sort of little note before I begin the presentation. This presentation is an abridged version of a longer paper. It will be a chapter. I anticipate that it will be a chapter in the book project that I'm currently working on. But since it's abridged, many of the examples and elaborations of the full version could not be included. So thanks for understanding this, and I'm happy to say more about the argument and to offer further examples in the discussion should it be desired. But I wanted to at least give a sense of the overall argument that the paper forwards. And so sometimes the examples fell by the wayside in the interest of just fleshing out the argument itself. And let's see here, I should share my slides. Give me one moment to do that. Is it possible to see the slides?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Great. Then without further ado, I will begin. The presentation should last just about 1.5 hour. And the presentation is structured in three parts. The first part is diplomats and the politics of transition in Macedonia. For a generation now, American and European diplomats have played an outsized role in the domestic politics of Macedonia, which in 2019 was renamed North Macedonia. Beginning in the 1990s, numerous foreign governments and international organizations, most notably the United States, the European Union, the United Nations, NATO, and the OSCE, have variously contributed resources and sponsored activities that aim to stabilize the young country amid the violence and volatility of Yugoslavia's breakup. Yet alongside official funds and programs, the American and European presence in Macedonia was also displayed and experienced through the diplomats stationed in or dispatched to the country. Across the 30 years of an independent Macedonia, these diplomats have acted as privileged commentators on Macedonian politics and political reform. With demonstrable regularity, American and European diplomats hold press conferences, give media interviews, issue reports, and make public statements, and appear at ceremonial events. In these forums, they express expectations, offer assessments, broadcast recommendations, extend praise, or issue warnings in relation to political decision-making in Macedonia. Through such interventions into the Macedonian public sphere, the diplomats positioned Macedonia as a supervised state, to use Jane Cowan's apt term, for countries subjected to international oversight and monitoring. I first noticed this phenomenon when conducting doctoral research in Macedonia in the mid-2000s, but the practice was still on ample display during my last extended research visit to Macedonia in 2018. When American or European diplomats offered public commentary on Macedonian politics, they were, of course, enacting a professional role, representing the interests and activities of the governments and organizations that employed them. However, through their professional conduct and public commentary, these political elites also performed and constructed a particular understanding of the post-Cold War international order. This presentation examines the public commentary of American and European diplomats in Macedonia in order to gain insight into the ideals and concerns that organized this scene of international politics. Or when the diplomats would broadcast their expectations for or assessments of the Macedonian political process, they often employed rhetorical strategies that downplayed interventionist intention. In turn, Macedonian political actors often used encounters with the press to underscore their own control over political decision making. This combination of practices, to be detailed below, suggests that the foreign presence in Macedonia triggered deep and perpetual anxieties about the degree and quality of Macedonia's state sovereignty. Were the Americans and Europeans overstepping the bounds of diplomacy in their commentary on Macedonian politics? Were Macedonian politicians too submissive to the powerful outsiders, Macedonians might ask? In this presentation, I argue that such concerns over Macedonian sovereignty came to organize the broader internationalized field of Macedonian politics. A note is thus warranted on the concept of political sovereignty. In the present day, the principle of sovereignty, conventionally understood as a state's monopoly of authority over a territorially bound political unit, is often asserted as the basis of the contemporary national order of things. This idea of formally equal sovereign states grounds institutions such as the United Nations and other more general figurations of the family of nations. Yet, as Jane Cowan's research on the League of Nations shows, practices of supernatural supervision emerged alongside and even co-constituted the modern regime of state sovereignty. The imaginary of an international order of sovereign states thus obscures how powerful states claims to territorial sovereignty depended on and produced polities where sovereignty is variously compromised, supervised, or suspended. To follow Gerimar Bonilla, I quote, "The sovereign nation is a myth, an aspirational model at best, even within the space of the North Atlantic, which has long relied on colonial markets, outsourced labor, and non-sovereign enclaves in order to sustain its claims to modern sovereignty," end quote. If sovereignty is a myth, however, let us note that myths are powerful things. They inform how people understand the world and how they construe their own actions. The public speech acts of both American and European diplomats and also Macedonian politicians thus provides revealing glimpses into how the myth of state sovereignty operates in the world today. In the particular case of Macedonia, anxieties about state sovereignty were indissociable from the political role of the United States, the European Union, NATO, the OSCE, and so on, adopted in the country following its independence from Yugoslavia in 1991. Like elsewhere in Eastern Europe, with the fall of state socialism, North Atlantic governments and organizations quickly positioned themselves as stewards along a path of liberalizing, democratizing political reform that came to be glossed as transition. In Macedonia, the wars of Yugoslav secession and the armed conflicts that engulfed the country in 2001 further inflected the international presence in the country as did Macedonia's formal pursuit of NATO and EU accession in the 2000s and the 2010s. The active presence of the international community in Macedonia, however, confronted what Andrew Gilbert has called the democratization paradox. As Gilbert describes in the case of Bosnia, foreign-led campaigns to establish democratic governance in post-war and traditional settings amount to a contradictory effort to impose democracy, that is, of promoting democratic ends through undemocratic means. American and European diplomats in Macedonia thus faced a recurrent challenge. On the one hand, they were expected to represent their governments and organizations' interests in promoting democratizing and liberalizing political reform. On the other hand, they had to avoid or counteract the perception that political reform was an imposition from the outside that solely or primarily reflected American and European interests. The challenge then was to steer democratic reform, but without undermining the state sovereignty that would legitimize the reform as democratic in the first place. Within this context, American and European diplomats in Macedonia repeatedly issued an interesting disavowal. Despite their persistent and often intense participation in Macedonian politics, time and time again, the diplomats would disclaim interventionist action and intention. Their involvements in Macedonian politics might be multiple, but so the diplomats would claim, they were not giving orders. They were not making demands. They were not overstepping their roles as outside observers, and they were not interfering in Macedonian lawmaking. Rather, again, according to the diplomats, they were there to support and to help Macedonia. I witnessed such disavowals oftentimes during my field research in Skopje, but perhaps never so clearly as when I had the opportunity to interview the US ambassador to Macedonia, Lawrence Butler, in October 2004. During his time in the position, the ambassador had achieved some degree of notoriety for his often outspoken and candid remarks on political issues facing Macedonia. This behavior had earned him the nickname Lawrence of Macedonia that suggested a colonial dimension to the American presence in the country. During the interview, Butler proved to be a loquacious, sharp observer of Macedonian politics. Over the course of our conversation, he sketched out his view on Macedonia's political problems. As he saw it, cronyism permeated political parties as well as the economy, which in turn perpetuated insularity, myopia, and resistance to change among the country's elites. What then of his vocal public commentary, I asked? What did he hope to accomplish with it? Without missing a beat, the ambassador elaborated that his job was, I quote, not to tell them, Macedonian political leaders, what to do, but rather to assist and motivate genuine political reform. To assist and motivate genuine political reform. To assist and motivate, not to tell them what to do. As Sadia Hartman has argued, strategies of disavowal remove the state, or in this case, the American-European diplomatic presence, political presence, from the domains that it in effect constitutes. Furthermore, in disavowing intervention, the diplomats also asserted the integrity of Macedonia's state sovereignty. If American and European governments and organizations were not telling Macedonian political leaders what reforms to implement, it followed that Macedonian political leaders were making their own sovereign decisions in their capacity as elected representatives of the Macedonian people. Yet oftentimes, these assertions of Macedonian sovereignty arose precisely at moments when American and European actions appeared to compromise that sovereignty. Diplomats' disavowal of political intervention in Macedonia thus signaled a deeper set of anxieties around the sovereignty myth and the consequences of state supervision. Although political theorists and statespersons alike often assume that the principle of territorial sovereignty grounds the modern international order, in historical perspective, this has never been quite true. Sovereignty is less a fact of the international order than a set of questions and arguments posed by it. For example, what are legitimate sources for sovereign power? When are violations of sovereignty justified? Which expressions of state sovereignty conform to international norms and which do not? Such an understanding recognizes, following Cynthia Weber, that rather than existing as universals, I quote, The means of sovereignty and intervention are inscribed, contested, erased, and reinscribed through historical practices, end quote. The inability of decontextualized and dehistoricized formulations of the sovereignty concept to grapple with these histories is what renders them myth. It is in this sense that Bonilla argues that sovereignty is a fiction. It is not, never has been, what it claims to be. Yet it is precisely this misfit between myth and history that unleashes anxieties about sovereignty. And so sovereignty can be evaluated and rated. If found either too much or too little for some particular state, interventions may be authorized to support, supplement, curtail, tame, discipline, or reestablish state sovereignty. As Bonilla elaborates, drawing on Michel Roque Trio, the sovereignty myth anchors a particular geography of imagination that categorizes some states as properly sovereign, while others are classed as failed states or in transition. This geography of imagination, in turn, authorizes a geography of management, manifested through practices of state building, international supervision, regime change, global governance, and indeed diplomatic commentary. However, as the Macedonian case illustrates, the geography of management organized by sovereignty's geography of imagination is often an anxious one beset by intractable, awkward paradox. Not to tell them what to do, let's recall Lawrence Butler's words, but rather to motivate and assist. My work thus traces how anxieties of sovereignty manifested within the Macedonian public sphere on politics and examines how political actors, both diplomats and Macedonian politicians, sought to dispel or channel these anxieties through public performances before the Macedonian press. In each case, the diplomats and politicians were responding to contradictions that resulted from the political relationships that constituted Macedonia's supervised state. European and American diplomats had to maneuver the contradictions of imposing democracy. Macedonian political leaders, however, faced a different paradox. For when disavowing agency in Macedonia's political reform, European and American diplomats underscored how Macedonian political leaders were the ones who were responsible for Macedonia's political future. Yet the diplomats also routinely reminded Macedonian publics that only one legitimate path existed for the future, namely the path toward Europe, which was portrayed as a promised land of prosperity, democracy, and security. Macedonian political leaders were thus faced with their own contradictory imperative to make a sovereign decision, but nonetheless to choose in accordance with European and American preferences, to choose, but to choose accordingly. Ultimately, however, I argue that these paradoxes could not be easily surmounted, reconciled, or diffused. Rather than settling or resolving questions about Macedonian sovereignty or Euro-American intervention, the actions of diplomats and political leaders only renewed and intensified them. That is, any performance or assertion of Macedonia's sovereignty would only provoke new doubts and anxieties about its lacks or excesses. In this way, the very question of sovereignty was a trap. Defined by paradox and contradiction, the question of Macedonian sovereignty, whether it was sufficient, appropriate, excessive, and so on, could ensnare actors in the effort to perform sovereignty or to disclaim intervention. However, such performances would only compel further attempts to tame or ignite, to assert or limit the dual forces of Macedonian sovereignty and international intervention. The sovereignty trap thus describes the structural doubt that foreign intervention casts on a country's independence and the spiraling assertions of sovereign sufficiency and insufficiency that follow from it. As I argue here, such a sovereignty trap ultimately came to organize Macedonia's post-conflict politics, and so entrenched the paradoxes of Macedonia's supervised state. Part two on the contradictory imperative. Allow me to begin with a vignette. To pee or not to pee? That was the question that Sasho Matsunovsky posed in an essay that was published in an August 2004 issue of the weekly political magazine Focus. Better known by his nickname Trendo, Matsunovsky rose to fame through his clever, sarcastic, and funny writing on Macedonian politics and society. In 2004, his career was reaching new heights as the inaugural host of the Macedonian language version of the hit game show franchise Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. At the time of the essay's publication then, Trenda was one of the most influential media figures and political commentators in Macedonia. His essay was titled in Macedonian, Svoje glavno, svoje rachno, which might be translated as stubbornly, selfishly, but that due to the roots of the words also conveyed the sense of with one's own head, with one's own hand, a wink to what is revealed to be the essay's focal question. The piece begins as Trendo relays a story about a recent evening when he had to confront an unnamed problem while sitting on his worn down easy chair. As he considered the situation, he realized the problem had one clear solution, but he worried that acting on it might bring him further troubles. Nevertheless, lacking better options, he formed, here I'm quoting my translation of the Macedonian original of the text, he formed a two-member committee consisting of his instinct and experience, and he gave them the task to work fast, efficiently, and non-transparently. Before too long, the simple conclusion was reached. Trendo, you must go and urinate. And so he did, an action that filled him with a complete joy. However, it was not the physical relief of micturition that left him so satisfied. No, said Trendo, the point was, and here again I quote, I took a piss without asking U.S. Ambassador Lawrence Butler what he thought about it. Trendo's satire makes light of the political power that American and European diplomats wielded in Macedonia, while also giving a sense of the sheer regularity and scope of diplomats' commentary on political issues. Whatever the problem might be, even something that seems so obvious as the need to urinate, diplomats would be there to frame the choices and clarify the stakes. Trendo thus writes in faux disbelief when reflecting on his unilateral decision to pee, as if such decision would be unthinkable. As the essay continues, again, this is my translation of the Macedonian original. Dude, seriously, I did it, riskily, stubbornly, selfishly. I eased the terrible pressure on my bladder without seeking the advice from the omnipotent butler, without listening to his wit and wise analysis. The framework procedure foresaw something completely different. Before I dare go to the toilet, it would be my turn to find out what the Supreme One, butler, thinks about it. Whether my decision was hasty or not, how it will reflect my relationships with the EU and NATO, which lately I'm so quickly approaching that it is only a matter of time before I start urinating with joy, whether this one nation move violates a clause of the UCRID agreement, how the signal I send might echo within the acoustic toilets of Brussels and Washington. With Bakhtinian Alon, Trendo recontextualizes the tropes that American and European diplomats so commonly used in their public remarks on Macedonian politics. Comments on hasty decisions, how decisions might affect the speed of Macedonia's Euro-Atlantic integration, on the sanctity of the UCRID framework agreement, which had ended Macedonia's 2001 armed conflict, and so on. As I argue elsewhere, through such comments, diplomats would telegraph American and or European approval or disapproval of policy proposals. Trendo thus parodies the linguistic register identified with diplomats and levels a critique of it by asserting the sheer banality of diplomats' seemingly incessant stream of evaluations and recommendations. Yet, Trendo's satire also brings another aspect of diplomats' political commentary into relief. The tendency to present and evaluate the choices that confront Macedonia in what was understood as its ongoing process of political reform. The essay itself is constructed around a problem that requires a decision, to pee or not to pee. This seems self-evident enough. But as Trendo Riley observes, within Macedonia during the post-conflict years, such decisions were often accompanied by diplomats' broadcasted advice and analysis, which would frame political issues in regard to Macedonia's Euro-Atlantic integration, the implementation of the UCRID framework agreement, and so on. For example, during the run-up to the 2004 referendum on municipal redistricting and on a municipal redistricting plan, American and European diplomats took to the Macedonian media to broadcast their analysis of the vote stakes. In a public letter, U.S. Ambassador Lawrence Butler wrote, "Colleagues, Macedonians will soon face an existential choice between a Euro-Atlantic future and a past which promises only insecurity and poverty. For the good of Macedonia, I hope that they will choose the first one." Similarly, when in Skopje 2 weeks later, U.S. Secretary of War Donald Rumsfeld stated that the Macedonian people face a clear choice between a future in NATO and the EU, where stability and economic growth can blossom, or a return to the past. Obviously, referendums, by their nature, present voters with a choice. What is significant here is how the diplomats frame that choice in public, invoking a spatio-temporal imaginary that linked the future to prosperity in Europe, and in contrast, linked the past to insecurity and the Balkans. In framing political issues in relationship to Euro-Atlantic integration and the Ohrid Framework Agreement, diplomats effectively reconstituted the choices facing Macedonian decision makers. A choice between keeping the new redistricting plan or reverting to the old redistricting plan was made into a choice between hastening Macedonia's Euro-Atlantic integration or risking being left outside of NATO and the EU. This practice of recontextualizing political issues, of making decisions into existential choices on Macedonia's future, was a common way in which American and European diplomats commented on and sought to regulate political discussion in the Macedonian public sphere. In his essay, Trendo anticipates this practice, describing how American and European diplomats might frame the choice that confronted him on that evening as he was sitting in his worn down easy chair. In terms of its implications for EU accession, NATO membership, and so on. But he also refuses such framings. Let us recall, he decides to bypass diplomatic commentary. Hence, Trendo's joy comes not from making a choice per se, but from acting outside of diplomats' framing and approval of his decision. In essence, Trendo revels in being a sovereign, of making a choice that was not answerable to another. By this reading of the essay, Trendo contrasts the omnipotence of Euro-American power as embodied in Lawrence Butler with his unthinkable ludic display of sovereign choice. In doing so, the essay stages a classic opposition between sovereignty and intervention and clearly expresses a desire for a sovereign Macedonia that could conduct its own business without the interference of Americans and Europeans. Indeed, this desire was a particular structure of feeling for many in post-conflict Macedonia. It might rear its head in many contexts, and understandably so. Yet there was an irony to Trendo's portrayal of post-conflict Macedonian politics and the role of American and European diplomats within it. For across their public commentary, American and European diplomats routinely encouraged Macedonian leaders to, in fact, make a decision. That is, in publicly framing the choices around some political matter, the diplomats also communicated that only Macedonians could decide on their country's political fate. Butler's and Rumsfeld's comments on the 2004 referendum on redistricting make this clear. But even years later, during the 2018 referendum on the Prespa Agreement, which would change Macedonia's name to North Macedonia, American and European diplomats would emphasize how Macedonians had the right and duty to make their own choices. As Federica Mogherini stated at a press conference, of course, the EU foreign minister, stated at a press conference just weeks prior to the vote on the Prespa agreement that would change the country's name, I quote, "You hold the keys to the future of your country. It is in your hands and only in your hands. Nobody else can do it for you. And you cannot afford to stay silent and miss this opportunity to express yourself on what kind of future you want for your country." At this level, the sovereignty of Macedonia was not questioned by the American and European diplomats. On the contrary, sovereign decision-making was insisted upon. Yet by so often framing the choices in stark moralized language, where one choice promised a radiant future and the other renewed misery, diplomats enacted the contradictory imperative that required Macedonians to make a choice, but also to choose accordingly. Statements that it was up to Macedonians to decide on their political future expressed not only that Macedonians should make a choice, but further that they ought to make the right choice, according to the European and American observers. The irony then is that both American and European officials and Macedonian political leaders seem to be on the same page. Both groups wanted Macedonians to make sovereign decisions. On the one side, Macedonians often resented American and European involvement in political matters and yearned to make independent political choices, without asking Lawrence Butler what he thought about it, to return to Trendo's point. Similarly, the American and European diplomats continually disavowed their own interventionist agency and urged Macedonians to make their own decisions, genuflecting towards Macedonian sovereignty and placing the onus of decision-making on Macedonian leadership. So what then prevented the alignment of the Macedonian desire to make a sovereign decision with the Euro-American desire that Macedonians make sovereign decisions? It is here that we encounter the sovereignty trap and the contradictions that grounded it. Diplomats were charged with directing Macedonian political reform, but were required to disavow intervention. The consequence was ongoing public commentary that would frame and evaluate the choices that awaited Macedonian political leaders. In turn, Macedonian political leaders were expected to make sovereign choices, but also to make choices in accordance with European and American preferences. In consequence, Macedonian political decisions were always tainted by the co-presence of European and American commentary. Any political decision reached by Macedonian lawmakers was born into a state of structural doubt. Was the decision truly sovereign? Was it sovereign in the right way? Indeed, the sovereignty trap and the structural doubt that it creates underwrites Trendo's satire. For once, he wants a decision to be unencumbered by the imperative to choose, but to choose accordingly. He desires to make a choice that is unconstrained by the process and evaluation of Euro-American authorities. In Macedonia's supervised state, however, as Trendo recognized, such decisions could be so unthinkable that they could make for a joke. So the final section, which wraps things up, which heads towards the conclusion. Across the post-conflict period then, both American and European diplomats and Macedonian political leaders entangled themselves in the sovereignty trap when responding to that paradoxical imperative of late 20th century state building that expected transitional states to make their own sovereign choices, but also to choose in accordance with North Atlantic models of liberal democracy. In many ways, the sovereignty trap incorporated longer standing colonial logics. American and European diplomats approached Macedonian politics in a paternalist pedagogic mode, claiming the authority to help and to assist, to teach and to motivate, to evaluate and to recommend within a process that promised Euro-Atlantic integration and its hegemonic framing of political modernity. At the same time, the diplomats and the institutions they represented expected performative displays of Macedonian sovereignty. Such displays were necessary to demonstrate Macedonia's autonomy and democracy. But they were also risky, as they might betray or exceed the normative vision of political modernity to which the diplomats subscribed. Macedonia's supervised state thus took the form of a vicious circle of commentary and response, of assertion and performance. In pedagogic mode, diplomats commented on Macedonian political affairs publicly and regularly. In performative mode, Macedonian political leaders asserted Macedonian sovereignty. However, the contradiction of the sovereignty trap, which demanded sovereign display while simultaneously undermining it, meant that these two modes could never satisfy one another. International paternalism would always produce its discontents in the form of sovereign assertions that differed from paternalist assumptions, such as the referendums and boycotts that have frequently appeared in Macedonian politics. Diplomats would then respond with more commentary, that is, repetitive serial efforts to label forms of sovereign display as inappropriate, according to Euro-Atlantic visions of liberal democracy. In short, American and European presence in Macedonia sprung a sovereignty trap that produced an ever-anxious space of sovereign performance, of performances that could not possibly satisfy the contradictory expectations that were placed on them. And that's it. Thanks for your attention. I would love to hear from you if you have any questions or comments, and obviously we'll have time for Q&A. But now I'll turn over the floor to Brendan, and I look forward to his comments.
Yeah, thank you so much, Andrew, for this eloquent analysis of the interplay between a well-meaning foreign intervention and a state sovereignty, or the myth of it. So Brendan, please, now the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. You can hear me correctly? Yes, fine. Well, thank you so much for both of you, particularly Andy. Great to be talking to you again. We go back some time. I was privy to the longer version of this text, the actual, so it more expanded, and maybe my comments will reflect that, but I think they'll all be relevant. I found this extremely good, a wonderful combination of a real sensitivity to political and diplomatic language, at the same time using your local knowledge, your empirical knowledge of, as you are an anthropologist first and foremost. I thought these two combined very, very well, a wonderful synthesis. And I found myself thinking a lot about the political language that came out of this, particularly sovereignty. In many ways, it's a rather I found myself thinking that, you know, having read this, that sovereignty, which I had not thought that much about in fairness, could now be added to some terms like security or legitimate interest or stability, words that when they're used in conflict or close to conflict situations are often have a particularly toxic ambiguity about them. Stability, of course, is the reason you go and invade a country to bring stability. It of course brings the opposite. And I was first of all a bit surprised by you very, very well conceptualize sovereignty as a trap. I was a bit surprised you used the term myth. But then I also remembered that back in the days when I did Middle Eastern stuff, that the term security was also described as a myth by Kanan Makia. He was referring particularly to the Israel-Palestinian conflict. And that's its own business. We don't need to bring it here. But thinking more about the sovereignty, an example from the Cold War came to mind. It's just anecdotal. I remember this reading the text that at the time, post-Cold War, and General Pinochet was arrested. I saw an interview with some people in Chile, very articulate young people, and they were outraged at this. I guess they said this is a gross violation of our sovereignty that an international judge would seek to arrest our ex-ruler. I wonder, I mean, I can't speak for these people, obviously, would they have considered the very illegitimate circumstances in which Pinochet was brought to power with the help of a certain northern neighbor who shall remain nameless? Would they also consider that to have been a violation of the sovereignty, which it more obviously was? So evidently, it as you've proven very well, it's a real moving target as a term. Also, I was thinking that the examples, this very heavy-handed, despite all the avowals of which you're very good at, you have a very good ear for them. This very heavy-handed paternalistic diplomacy, it does, it seemed to me, and again, I'm privy to an example that you didn't give here, but I can mention it. It seems to me that this does seem to open the door to the famous unintended consequences of social action. I mean, if we remember another Middle Eastern example, sorry about this. but I mean, George Bush, whom you mentioned in the text, if you recall at one stage when was obviously in very bad relations with Arafat and Fatah, he called upon the Palestinian people to elect new leadership. Well, they did. They elected Hamas, which was considerably worse from the point of view of a West security perspective. But I mean, who else were they going to vote for? The Green Party of Gaza? Nonsense. And you know, the thoughtlessness of this. Now, the example that comes to mind here, and again, I found it very interesting that the phrase strategic non-cooperation as a kind of a local way of pushing back was precisely something that you had studied before in great detail, the construction of the Skopje antiquation project. And this was a way of local politicians snubbing the international community. Of course, it had to do with the name and the difficult relationship with Greece and so forth. But that struck me as an example of exactly unintended consequences, that, you know, we push these people, tell them what to do, or I mean, it's never that. It's more subtly worded than that. That is what's intended. There's bound to be some degree of kickback from that, and that was then the evident example of that. This text was so good, no particular questions formulated themselves for me, but I think I would push one or two perhaps. I mean, have there been other concrete examples locally of pushback, of inat? I didn't know Macedonians use the term inat this way, the Serbs do. That sense of stubbornness, frustration, whatever, that we're going to do it our way. That would be one question. Another I found, is sovereignty always a myth? Because as you've proven that there's various degrees of sovereignty, and obviously it's bound up with how small or great a particular power is. I mean, Macedonia is obviously a highly compromised country in that way. It's bringing very little to the table itself. But could we really speak about a very powerful hegemonic country as its own sovereignty would be somehow a myth as well? It's getting a bit on the theoretical side. I can't remember the exact quotation, but the idea that the United States would, its own sovereignty would be a myth because it's compromised by the flow of migrant labor or international markets, I don't find that entirely convincing. If you would care to comment on that. Did I have a third question? Yes, again, that sensitivity to language. The term transition, of course, is used for several of the post-Yugoslav states. And I'm just wondering if by boxing a certain country or society as transitional or in transition, is that already outside stakeholders giving themselves permission to have a greater degree of intervention there? And I think I would leave it with those with those three related questions.
Thank you, Brendan, for this really rich set of remarks and questions. So much good stuff to think about, and I do appreciate the examples from the Middle East and elsewhere. Since especially as an anthropologist, we really like to think comparatively. There's maybe a few points that you raised that I might respond to. I'll try to do so quickly so there's time for more general questions. But I first appreciated how you drew out the similarities between sovereignty and concepts like security, legitimate interest, and stability. And this was something as I've been reading up on the kind of the political theory regarding sovereignty. One of the works that I found most interesting was Anthony Anghi's work on international law and the history of the sovereignty concept, where he went back to look at old Iberian jurists who, according to his analysis, were some of the first to articulate the political concept of sovereignty in the context of the Spanish and Portuguese colonization of the Americas. And by his analysis, sovereignty, there was this assumption that, okay, you have these American societies, indigenous societies, and they have their own political order. They are sovereign in their own terms, as Spain, the Spanish crown would have its own sovereignty. But the articulation of the concept really emerged through its violation, whereby the failure of indigenous societies to make proper diplomatic overtures to the Spanish and Portuguese sailors and soldiers who arrived on the South American continent or in the Caribbean was construed as a violation of Spanish and Portuguese sovereignty, which therefore authorized the Spanish crown and the Portuguese crown to undertake military action to reassert their sovereignty after it had been denied by these indigenous societies. So there's this way, at least according to his analysis, that sovereignty has always been an alibi, right? It's always been, in some sense, a cover to allow action in its name, rather than sort of existing as you know, kind of objective concept by which you can assess, you know, these polities are sovereign, these polities are not sovereign. And I think, at least according to, you know, my analysis, I'm sure it's evident in what I just presented, I feel that quality of the sovereignty concept, you know, it, you can see its legacies in the present as well. On the unintended consequences of the kind of diplomatic paternalism that I analyze, I think you're absolutely right to point to Skopje 2014, which, for those of you who don't know, was undertaken by former Macedonian Prime Minister Nikola Gruevski, and it amounted to a large-scale transformation of Macedonia's capital, Skopje, where there were giant monuments and sculptures and buildings that were made all in kind of neoclassical and Baroque style, culminating in an 8-story tall statue of a mounted Alexander the Great. And it was considered quite early on as being, you know, an exercise in a populist nationalism, which was quite problematic in the Macedonian case, especially since it's a multinational and multi-ethnic society. But it was very much, I think, needs to be read in relationship to this kind of diplomatic paternalism. And as at least in my own kind of pet analysis, what's interesting with Skopje 2014 is Gruevski essentially discarded American and European diplomats as sort of the primary addressees, outside addressees of his you know, signature policies, and rather sort of replaced them with an idea of kind of global capital. So who cares what the EU says or what, you know, the State Department says? Rather, let's bring in tourists, let's bring in investment, and that's where we will build Macedonian sovereignty. But I would continue to argue it still plays into this logic of the sovereignty tramp. So Gruevski's muscular demonstrations, or his attempts at muscular demonstrations of Macedonian sovereignty, just kind of continued more diplomatic condemnation or criticism of his actions that led to further assertions of Macedonian sovereignty, so that the kind of the cycle just perpetuates itself. You know, once you, and this is why I use this language of the trap. Traps are not easy to get out of, you get stuck in them. And I think it becomes a way to even think about what happened during Gruevski's time in power in Macedonia. He left the office of the prime minister in 2017. Subsequently, he was arrested for under corruption charges, but fled the country and is now fugitive to Macedonia law in Hungary because Viktor Orban granted him a political asylum. They were cronies. But so thank you for that point. But I think it kind of nicely fits into the argument that I'm trying to build from this earlier moment in Macedonia's political history. Then just quickly then to the couple of final points that you raised. Is sovereignty always a myth, even for major powers? I guess I do kind of side with Jerimar Bonilla's point. She makes it in her lovely book, Non-Sovereign Futures, that even, you know, a country like the United States, right, a world power, superpower, something like this, it relies on, it depends on all different kinds of like sovereign excesses and lacks. Her terminology was non-sovereign enclaves, colonial markets, so on and so forth. But I think part of this understanding, at least the understanding that I think she's putting forward and that I'm putting forward, is to say that when you start evaluating one country's sovereignty, instead of looking at sovereignty as a more general structure of argument making, it's kind of to focus on a tree instead of looking at the forest. And I'm trying to make a claim about the forest of sovereignty and how it's structured and how it, precisely the way it's structured in the present, and I think it's, you know, has longer colonial history behind it, is that it's precisely the space of asking questions. You know, well, is Macedonia sovereign? Is it sovereign in the right way? You know, are the Palestinians sovereign? Oh, wait a minute, they elected Hamas. Is that being democratic in the wrong way? Is the United States exceeding, you know, is it violating other countries' sovereignty? Is it in itself sovereign? Is it too sovereign? Something like this. This is the problem space of sovereignty talk that I think leads to things like the sovereignty trap. As for transition, I think it's sort of one sort of historically specific political discourse by which these sovereignty questions got organized. If in pointing to Jane Cowan's work on the League of Nations, for example, and earlier work on, I more hinted at it than actually cited it or elaborated on it, but a longer history of colonialism, I'm at least making the argument that, you know, there's a much deeper history here beyond transition, but I think transition became, you know, one primary way in which these relationships were discussed and acted upon in the wake of the Cold War and the fall of the Soviet Union. And then maybe as for other examples of pushback, I can go into a lot of them, but maybe in interest of time, we can see if there's some other questions and maybe I can give some of the examples and my answers to them. But while there were other examples of pushback, there are also other ways in which Macedonian politicians, I think, would respond to diplomatic commentaries in ways that may not have just been kind of, you know, rejection or refusal, but often kind of interesting forms of like alignment, appropriation, parody, so on and so forth. But thank you, Brendan, for these really great questions. I've just kind of this, you know, my response is just the tip of the iceberg. Early responses have given me a lot to think about it, and I really appreciate it.